Tour Guides 导游俱乐部。
Hello, hello, guys and girls. This is Jerry. Welcome back to the program. And today, I'm gonna be talking about Chinese silk and the silkworm. As everyone knows, silk is one of the best materials for clothing that has hardly any match in the world. Reputed to be the queen of fabrics, it is light, lustrous,and durable. Also, it has the advantages of being soft to touch, resistant to heat, and breathing very well. All these features made it an ideal fiber for beautiful satins, charming brocade, and attractive dresses. If one goes to a traditional opera house in China, one will find people from well-to-do families in silk dresses.Which are believed to be commensurate with their social status. China is the first producer of silk in the world. Silk production was studied in the country about 4,500 years ago. And today, centers of silk production are stringed along rivers in South China, in Suzhou and Hangzhou.For instance, in the lower reaches of Yangtze River in Foshan in South China, and in Nanchong in Southwest China, and many other areas as well, where silkworms are bred. Silkworm breeding is done by the farmers in the rural areas. It takes an average of 26 to 27 days for a silkworm, which is no bigger than an ant.To grow old enough to spin a cocoon. In the very hot summer days, the breeding season lasts merely 22 to 23 days. In other seasons, it might be 30 days or so. The farmers used to breed the worms twice a year, in spring and autumn. Now, however, the farmers do the silkworm breeding three, four, or even five times a year, provided the mulberry leaves, the only food for the worms, are available. Silkworms are delicate creatures. They can be easily killed by rats, mosquitoes, and flies, or by the dust on the mulberry leaves. That's why cat is a very common animal in every silkworm village.That's also why farmers will limewash the rearing house before the breeding season sets in, and will sometimes clean the mulberry leaves one by one before they feed them to the worms. Silkworms are hungry creatures too. They eat a lot. In fact, they have to be fed every 4 hours, including at night. In Wuxi,where sericulture is a major business, female farmers are said to take as much care of silkworms as they do their own babies. Hence, silkworms are given the intimate name, delicate babies. Now, as they eat a lot, they drop a lot. The droppings of the silkworms make an excellent manure.Which is far superior to many chemical fertilizers. Silkworms are heavy sleepers by nature. They keep eating the leaves for a couple of days and then go to a long sleep. In a lifetime of 20 to 30 days, a silkworm goes to 4 long sleeps, each of which lasts about 24 hours.When they wake up from a long sleep, they plunge into eating the leaves with a bigger appetite. The last sleep is the longest sleep, about 36 hours or even more. When they wake up, they're ready to spin cocoons. To show their readiness to spin, the worms will raise 4 legs, not the hind legs. The women farmers will pick them up one by one from where they stay, which is usually a bamboo tree, and put them onto a straw mountain. Of course, it is not a real mountain, just straw arranged like the spokes of the wheel. The farmers have to see to it that no two silkworms stay too close, otherwise they're likely to make one cocoon instead of two. And the silk thread will get mixed up and serve no real purposes. The spinning process extending 3 to 4 days is a fascinating one, which has given rise to a Chinese idiom, spinning a cocoon around oneself, which means making rules and regulations only to have one's own hands and feet bound. Now, what happens is that glutinous stuff that comes out of the mouth of a fully grown silkworm is a long, long thread that goes round and round worm, glued together. At the beginning, one will see a thin film of a silk thread through which the worm is visible. When the spinning process is over, the cocoon is made, and the worm is wrapped inside, invisible. When the cocoons are made, the farmers will pick them up and put them into the bamboo basket. Then they will transport them to the purchasing center set up by the silk companies. There, heating has to be done in a good time to all the cocoons in order to kill, or rather stifle, the chrysalises inside. If they fail to do this, the worms will transform themselves from chrysalises into moth and break out of the cocoons, rendering them useless for reeling purposes with a hole in each of them. Needless to say, not all the cocoons are heated. A few are selected and preserved for the next generation. All right, this is all the story about the Chinese silk and silkworm. Hope you learned something and like it. Thanks for listening. See you next time.
Copyright, tourguides.com.cn. All rights reserved.